let's move on to bulk carriers. Like I told you, the bulk carriers started after the general cargo ships more or less, you know, found it is impossible to cater to so much of demand of bulk cargoes and other things. So in the end, bulk carriers became independent. And this whole action started practically in 1960s, you know, late 50s. So now what is the one of the major issues with bulk cargoes is, it is raw material. Most of the bulk cargo is a raw material. And it is obviously much cheaper than the finished products. So the economics goes in such a way that it can't be very expensive for transportation. Its value is low. So it works in a little different way. So bulk carriers come in all shapes and sizes, in simple words. Okay, there are many sizes. The smallest ones may be just about 2000 tons deadweight capacity with the draft of only about 1.5 meters, 2 meters. And the bigger ones can be something like 450,000 tons. And probably they will be crossing 500,000 tons soon. But the bigger ones generally are on contract, like between the two ports. That's it. Bulk carriers always have got one loaded passage, one empty passage. It is unlike cargo ships that both sides all the time they are full. No, this is empty passage and loaded passage. They don't have twin decks. Why? Because there's a big area, you just dump bulk in it and that's it. Now what happens is, the big ships, of course, they need much deeper waters and all, which is not available everywhere. To have a deep water port and all, it costs money. And the cargo is not that expensive, so it doesn't really justify for many countries that to have a deep water bulk terminals. Because after all, after discharging the bulk, you have to take it somewhere. Where are you going to take it? Take it to the factory. The factory may not be nearby port. Whereas, Japanese steel industry is in ports. You know, means what happened? They made the steel industry and then they made the berths also. So, the ship can come alongside there directly. So, you will find this pattern in many countries that you have got the factory or company or whatever you call it, the whole installation of a huge steel mill is in port, and it has worked well for all the economy. Then what happens is, country like India has got other issue. We have got coastline, but we have got hardly any friendly places on the coast. Friendly places means it is where there should be natural weather protection and all. We don't really have it. So in spite of long coastline India has got, it is not really productive. But anyway, governments always try to create local employment, everything. So they give concessions to people to open up steel mills and all, steel factories, power stations, thermal power stations. So there, the same concept is used that it is just next to water and it needs the same things like any other steel mill is going to need, like about 8-10 shipments of iron ore and then one shipment of coal, because they need carbon to mix up for a steel. Now, all well said and done, but big ships cannot go alongside where India doesn't have that sort of deep water. It's a lot of rocky areas, so you can't really have deep water port. But we have got ports which are suitable for shallow waters. Why? Because there is not that much of deep water. Trying to make a deep water port doesn't justify the size of the industry and spending that much of money. So what we do is, ship comes to nearby anchorage, that means where you have got deep water, ship anchors there, and then this medium-sized ships have got their own cargo gear, cranes and grabs. They discharge into small mini bulks or whatever you call it. Okay, they are like barges, self-propelled barges, but they are like bulk carriers. Discharges into that, 2,000 tons gone, 2,000 tons gone, 2,000 tons gone, like that it continues as an endless cycle till all cargo is finished. And these smaller ones go to the factory berths, from where the cargo can be transported on conveyor belt to wherever they need inside. Now, steel factories and all are huge areas, huge. You know, I mean, thousands of acres. So, then this economic works. So, now that's what happens on Indian coast, like in Mumbai. Ships anchor. Cargo is discharged. Goes to Alibag and those areas. There are two or three steel mills there. Okay, one Vikram is spared, then there is another one, and then there is another one in Revdanda, you know. So, same mode of transportation. So, those are the small bulk carriers. Medium size, the ones which come to Mumbai, carry, bring the cargo and discharge it. Loading ports always, because you know that old fashioned stuff is over, like what used to be in Goa with loaders and all. Loading ports generally make their own deep water port, okay, because cargo is transferred by conveyor belts. And then a lot of places, then there are loaders, the similar system like I explained you, the small bulk carrier carries it from a small jetty, brings it to deeper or bigger one, and then it's loaded. That is also followed. That's what I have shown you in pictures earlier. Now what happens is, these are the typical ships. What is the problem with them? First thing, they don't load on deck or hatch covers. So they need not be that strong like cargo ships which do load on the decks. But they have got strong hold decks. Why? Because they do carry much more weight than the general cargo ships in the hold. So the tank tops are strong. Then they carry two types of cargoes, extra heavy cargoes and light cargoes. Light cargo is like grain, wheat, you know, or a corn and all. These are light cargoes. So one will fill up the ship with volume, yet ship will never reach the draft. Other one is so heavy that ship is loaded fully, but there's so much of volume is empty. You get both cargoes. Now the problem with both cargoes, when the cargo is very heavy, center of gravity is much closer to the keel. That creates an M is point above that. So the GM, what we consider, which you will be studying later on in next semester or so, or semester after that, it becomes too stiff. Now what you need is a reasonable, neither too long or short, nor short. So you need reasonable height. So what happens is, if you are going to carry cargoes like ores, which are heavy, what you do is you raise the height of double bottom tanks. You raise the height so center of gravity moves away from the keel. So the originally, if we were planning on paper, GM was so much, now it will be less. So it is in reasonable limits. And light cargoes is not a problem. Generally, the GM is reasonable. No problem. Now another problem comes up. Grain cargoes, when you load, now you can experiment at home also. You take any bulk, sugar, rice, wheat, anything, and just try to pour it. You will find it makes a small mountain-like thing, you know, a hill with sloping surfaces. Now that's what happens when you load grain. Now if you had a ship with a rectangular cross-section like this, What will happen is when you start loading cargo, first it will be like this. Like this. You are still loading. Once it reaches here, then maybe it will become like this. Okay. in this what happens is, even if top I can push one way or the other, here fill it up one way or the other, thoda thoda dalo, thoda thoda dalo, take care. But this remains empty. This remains empty. Now suppose ship is rolling heavily. If ship is rolling heavily, we can have an issue that this cargo from top can shift here, fill it up completely, and ship will get tilted. Now you realize one thing, this is along the ship's length, so volume involved is large. If ship gets tilted like this, ship can sink. It has happened in the past. Ships sank. That is the reason this part needed some sort of a better design. And that is what we have achieved it in the bulk carrier. So, then another one comes here. Okay, I'll show you here only. Not here, it's very difficult. I'll show you on that one. Next one. Now, this is the side view. Okay, what is the difference between the cargo ship and this? Bow is same. Foremast is same. Forecastle, forepeak area, all the ships, this area the same. Okay, all the ships. Except you take car carrier and all. But everybody will have forepeak tank and collision bulkhead. It's compulsory, mandatory. Then you have got hole number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Double bottom is going bit from 1 to 5. Like I have mentioned it yesterday also, there is no double bottom in forepeak or in engine room. So it travels all the way. Hatch covers are like same thing. Cranes are there. Superstructure is there. Engine room is there. What is this dotted line? We have got some tanks on the top which are called topside tank or upper side tanks. Upper side tanks or top side tanks. So you also have got a hopper area here. Purposes are different, okay, but there is a hopper side here and the tank is extended up to here. This is called lower side tank or hopper side tank. This is the difference between those two ships. So you have to know how to draw the side view of the ships. The hull shape is one, and then you add, subtract, that you will see as we move on. Now cross section view. Okay. No, wing side is a different one. When we say wing, those tanks extend from top bulkhead to the bottom. That is wing tank. Here it is only top side. You see the shape of it. You remember I told you that if I have to load the bulk, it would have been something like this, right? So there was a void area here which could get filled up. Therefore, instead of allowing these things to happen, we know that we can't load anything there when we are loading full bulk. So we create cavities here called tanks. So cargo cannot go it. Cargo has to follow the lines. Cargo has to follow the profile lines. So cargo is not going to go there. So that shifting problem we have solved. If you are loading full. Got it? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now another thing. What happens? If I am loading or discharging using grabs, whether they are connected to ship's crane or the shore crane. When you take out a cargo, you take out like this, you know, grab it, lift up. Grab it, lift up. Now that has to travel only in vertical line. Like this, correct? So here I can pick up everything, you know, I'll scrape it off from the bottom and I'll lift it up. What happens if I did not have this upper side? If I did not have upper side, I will have cargo like this, okay? The middle part is taken care of by the grab, but I will have cargo sticking like this in the end. Now, to dig it into it and bring it out, it is going to take lot of time. That is the reason you don't want that, you know, waste of time while discharging. Arre, kaam karo, it's too slow. That is the reason we create hopper side here. That means all the cargo will slide it here. When it slides underneath, I can lift up and there is much faster job. Yes, in the end, there is a sweeping done. But it will be much, much faster operation in the port. Everybody is happy with it. Ship owner wants ship back to sea. Port doesn't want ship in. They want to use only productive time. So they don't want empty ship unnecessarily wasting time. So everybody is happy with the arrangement except us, because we can't go ashore that long time. So this is the reason you have got hopper side created here. Now if you have created another cavity here, obviously you will fill it up with water on a ballast passage. Otherwise it is empty. When cargo is inside, it is empty. Now see the difference. Okay, if my cargo is heavy type of cargo, okay, heavy cargo is like this. When you are discharging, that time only hopper side comes in picture. That cargo will slide here. But these top tanks do not have any meaning. Why? Because cargo doesn't reach there. But if you are loading lighter cargo, cargo is going to fill up completely till hatch covers, and still you will have capacity left, the weight capacity. Volumetric capacity will be over, but weight capacity will be still left. Now, some ships, older designs, especially older designs, because it's no longer feasible today for economical reasons. Some of these tanks are also permitted for grain loading. Why? Because I am filled up here and I still have weight capacity available. But you know the tank is sealed from inside completely here. So there are bottom side has got some holes, bleeder holes, which are always kept closed. And when you have to use it, you open it up and allow it to bleed in the hole. And loading, how will you load? You can't load it from here. So there is an opening on deck also, which you have to open up and you load through that. Then these tanks will add up extra capacity. So then these tanks are also called grain tanks. Means they are permitted to load grain. I have sailed on the ships which we have. I have even loaded in that also. But today, this all job for that small capacity of a cheap cargo. Grain is considered a cheap cargo. More expensive than ore, but still not that expensive either. So, this operation, opening, closing, loading something, after that discharging time, it will keep on bleeding down as this level goes down. And then you have to go and sweep it inside. It is too expensive. So normally ships will not have, but in case you get any reference to grain loading tanks, these are the topside tanks which can load grain with special operation. Got it? Got it, yes, or sir. No? Yes, no.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Yes, sir.
If you remember this, good enough. But nowadays you are not going to find ships because it has become simply not practicable. It is, you know, in the end what happens, you have to watch out how much money you are spending and whether it's a feasible or no. Now we come to the, now we took care of this topside tank. What is the topside tank? What is the purpose of it? Topside tank's purpose is to avoid void space in the wings where cargo can shift. One second, let me see one thing. No, sorry, I needed to just check it if the recording was on, otherwise I would have got a surprise. Okay. This is the typical cross section of a bulk carrier. See, there are commons, that's the reason you should be able to draw this shape. Now, up to here the shape should be there, and then you decide what type of shape it is and how to create. The outer shell you should be able to draw. Outer shell. Hatch cover is there, deck plating, why? Because this is main deck, upper deck or weather deck. Then this is bulwark. Yesterday I showed you the hatch combing stay. This is hatch combing, and hatch combing stay means support members like this. And here some. Okay. So those are bulwark stays or the hatch combing stays. And that is where we say the top part is over. Now comes rounded gunwale. Gunwale is part under bulwark is gunwale, spelled as G-U-N-W-A-L-E, not gunwale. Okay, it is not gunwale, it is gunwale. Actually, you may find gunwale as a surname also in India. Some trading communities have got names like this. Okay, it is normally rounded, it is not rectangular. The reason is it is much better to avoid cracks there. Topmost straight is shear straight. Okay, topmost. After that, the deck plating will come. So the topmost is shear straight. You have got a side plating, shell plating, side shell plating. Top plating is deck plating, bottom plating is keel plating. And on two sides, you have got side shell plating. And you call it shell plating. Whole thing is shell plating. Then there is a cargo hold. This is a cargo hold. Now we'll move little bit down. Okay. Now we have got this hopper side created, right? For the purpose here is to slide the cargo in the center square for ease of discharging. So, these are lower side tanks. Now, these lower side tanks, it is possible some ships, they are connected with a pipeline. Once upon a time, this is avoided because, these pipelines can get corroded, it's avoided. But it is possible an odd ship you may find. Otherwise, these upper tanks, upper side tanks or top side tanks are independent tanks. This may be connected to the double bottom. Mostly it will be connected. It will not be independent tank. The lower side tank need not be independent tank. It's possible it can be, but need not be. Generally, one avoids it. Itna chota volume ke liye kya naya bada wala banane ka, it may absorb it. So it's absorbed in double bottom tank. Other parts, rounded bilge. Do you know the bilge radius? This is the bilge radius. Rounded bilge, it is also known as bilge strake. Bilge strake, that is this part. It is the bilge strake. Then this is bilge keel, this part. This is what we have done already. Bilge strake, bilge plate, whatever you call it. Double bottom tank, lower side tank. Now we come to garboard strake. Now what happens? The center strake. Strake is what? A strip of plates running in fore and aft direction. Strip where they are joined. One joint, then another joint, and like that it becomes long. That is the center strake. The center one, it is called keel strake. It is slightly thicker than the side ones. But it is keel strake. The one runs in the center. There is only one keel strake. It doesn't have port and starboard. There is only one. Then it has got strakes on the side. Because this is the first one. Then there is a side one. There is another side one. Now the first ones on both the sides. Port side as well as starboard side is called garboard strake. These are old names coming from sailing ships. But just remember garboard strake. Garboard strake is also known as A strake. Keel strake is a K, and then garboard strake is there, which is known as strike A, then strike like strike A, strike B, strike C, like that it goes up till it finishes at shear strike. Now what happens is, if we go back to this drawing again, okay, see what happens is, we got large number of tanks here, and you have to have ballasting, deballasting arrangement. So that is an engine room. So the pipeline must run all the way for number one here, number two here, number three here, number four, number five, port, center, starboard. So 15 tanks there on this ship, plus four big tanks, 16. Then you have got a bilges, 10 bilges. 26 pipelines you are going to run. Now you are going to add weight. You are adding extra pipelines. So what we do is, earlier we had similar systems, but we had lots of problems. Why? Because the valves were on top. You know, you have to operate from wherever I can operate. It's connected with a spindle, means a pipe, with some connections in the middle. Sometimes connection is to break. I cannot operate the valve. So how do I remove the pipe? The cargo is already in the hold. I cannot reach to take out water, deballast water. So I lose the loading capacity. So there were many issues. So the architects solved it. They said, instead of that, why don't we make one pipe and then we'll put small branches. And let us have hydraulic valves instead of manual valve. By the time technologies had improved and hydraulic valves were there, electric valves were there, so they automatically operate from remote position. So we'll fix up remote ones. Why not here? Let us reduce the weight of the ship also, no? Because the heavier the ship means lesser the capacity. So what happened? For example, you put one pipe here. Okay, for example, this is the cross section of the pipe. This is going through and through in fore and aft direction. One end is in engine room, other one end is going all the way to four pick tank. And we connect one pipe here, one pipe here, and put a valve here. Now what happens is, I have left a tunnel in the middle of the ship. So one side is a double bottom tank here, other one is double bottom here. In between, in double bottom space, I create a tunnel. What tunnel carries all sorts of pipelines, hydraulic pipelines to open close valves. All the valves are inside. Then there are many pipelines. Okay, that used to be the problem earlier days. So today all the pipelines will be in the tunnel. Some electric cables and lot of stuff will be there going through that, because it's much safer. Tunnel will be about 2 meters wide. You're not going to waste the capacity either, but you will make it convenient where the pipelines can go. You can work there in case. Now what happens in case some problem comes? I can still reach this spot. How do I reach? I go to engine room. We open one opening manhole cover. We go inside. This tunnel has got independent lighting. It has got full independent ventilation system. It has got a rail track and there is a trolley there. A rope is tied up so that you can pull and you can move the trolley in whichever direction you want. Trolley has got a brake, because if trolley starts running on its own, you will need to stop it. So that is why there is a brake system. And there is a locking system. So when you are not using it, trolley is locked at the entrance. Otherwise, you will go down and say, where is the trolley? So trolley is locked at the entrance. So I go in engine room, open it, go inside. And then whatever the problem is there, I go and solve it. Now, other end is all the way to collision bulkhead. From there is another opening through which I can climb out forward. So that is normally a different type of shaft from where you get out. The engine room one is a short one. means you just step down few steps and you are right in the bottom place, because engine will be from this height, you will be going down. Whereas forward end, you may be coming out right on top to the main deck, so it will be long shaft. Now most of the ships, all long ships, means practically all the long ships will have this. Short ships may be there, may not be there, but normally most of the ships are long today. So I'm talking about the ships like 200 meters and on will always have the duck keel. It is called duct keel. In that you have got all pipelines and hydraulic valves, etc. located. This duck keel may be a single one on the center line. Maybe there are two duck keels and then they merge into one. All these things are possible. But basic purpose is for various pipelines and so on. I have been on container ship where we had two from engine room. And then they used to merge into one and then. So it depends on the ship. But duck keel's purpose is to carry pipelines. So, you understood duck keel? Yes, no?
Yes, sir.
Any questions?
Yes, sir.
Any questions on bulk carrier? See, remember, wing tank is the one which goes from main deck to the bottom. Okay? That is wing tank. Otherwise, they are side tanks. Because side tanks, see, this is up to here. Then there is a framing here. Then there is a hopper side. Okay? Now, sometimes you will find, the especially container ships and all, you have got wing tanks. Tankers, you have got wing tanks. You don't have upper side tanks and lower side tanks. Okay, the reason is because container ships don't carry those types of cargo. They carry only boxes. So, any doubts at this stage? Yes, no?
No, sir.
Okay. Anybody having doubt?
No, sir.
Okay, good. So, we move on to the oil tankers. Now, see, generally you get one question in types of ship, features of the ship. So, now here let's say oil tanker. All tanker, oil tankers have a double skin to, I will say, reduce. I cannot use word eliminate, because if impact is too strong, then it may not work. But idea is to minimize or reduce the risk. On oil tanker, they have a double skin. Now what happens is, they have got center tanks, side tanks. Means port side tank, starboard side tank and center tank. And for ease of cleaning, because you know tankers, every time a product may be little different. So you cannot mix up old cargo, new cargo, contamination issues are there. So for cleaning and all, attempt is made to keep sides smooth. But it is not always possible, but it is still tried. And any horizontal framing has got drain holes and all, so the cargo comes down and then there is a cargo, crude oil washing and all for crude oil ships. Generally, the product carriers are much cleaner because the oils are clean. And then there is a way to, you know, like you can mix up kerosene with diesel, little bit, minute quantities. So it will not affect, something like that. There are ways and means to do it. Now, there is another type of framing which is uses corrugated framing. Corrugated is like what you see these metal sheets, no? Nowadays you find for fencing and all, use those are corrugated. It doesn't have frames. It is built-in frames. That is corrugated. Built-in frames is a corrugated. Then, ballast tanks surround cargo tanks from all the sides. So, during loaded passage, that is the empty space around the oil. During empty passage, there is a ballast, so that is another issue altogether. Every tanker has got a pump room. Then ballast tank pipelines, everything is isolated so that there cannot be contamination with oil. Tankers have got inert gas system. All the tankers will have inert gas system. Why inert gas system? You do not want atmospheric oxygen to come in contact with hydrocarbon vapors to form explosive mixtures. So instead of atmospheric air, we keep on pumping inert gas. Inert gas is generally exhaust gas, clean, washed and all, and then it is injected. Today, lots of ships have got now nitrogen generators. So inert gas is replaced by nitrogen. Then, crude oil washing system is on crude oil ships. Okay, there are some rules, the smaller ones did not have and all, but generally it's not the case. Most of the ships, what you are going to go on, they will be crude oil ships with a crude oil washing system. Means you wash the tank first with the crude oil only, because since the residue is from that, it will dissolve in it and it will be pumped out. So settlement, the sediments will be pumped out. Now tankers are called type A ship. Why? Because they got minimum openings. Minimum openings on deck through which water can enter in case of accident. They are very minimum. Whereas the other ships have got openings like hatch covers, which is a weak area. In case something goes wrong, the whole hold gets flooded. So that is why the safety margin must be higher. So if you take ships of identical size, the tanker can always load more cargo in weight than the other one. The reason is the minimum opening, so they are called type A ships. Every other ship other than tanker is called type B. There is no C and D. Either you are A or you are B. Finished. Then they have got lower freeboard, so there is a raised walkway from the superstructure to the forward forecastle. You can walk on top. There is a walkway. It is also referred as catwalk. Okay. But catwalk is not the correct word. Catwalk was, what you say, one of the naughty comments. Why? Because everybody at sea feels like a model. So you are walking on a catwalk. But catwalk is not the correct word. It's a walkway. It is a safety walkway with all the safety features. You always load and discharge cargo on tankers with pipelines. Now you have got your fixed pipeline structure and the cargo is either to be pumped out or so you need a connection to the shore piping system. It is same thing if you are used to having water tankers coming. What happens? Tanker has got its own thing. Your ground tank has got own thing. So somebody has to connect a pipe in the middle and that guy opens the valve and water comes to your tank. Similarly, we have to connect a pipeline. Now our pipelines are huge. Huge. It's not possible to lift them with hand. So what happens is, what place we have got, where the ends of the pipes are there, where you have to connect, that we call it as a manifold. Next to manifold, there is a crane to lift up the pipe, this pipeline, flexible pipeline, bring it and then connect it. So that is why you need two cranes. Now you also have tools and anti-pollution stuff and all. So nearby that crane, you will always have one each side. Each side you will have a deck house to keep some stores, which are required all the time. You can't be going up and down and like a spanner, like a no. So all the required things are kept there. And then somewhere in the middle, you also have venting pipes. You know, one pipeline goes up. Because when there is extra pressure, you have to release the pressure. Releasing pressure means what? It's a mixture of hydrocarbon gas as well as inert gas. Both are dangerous for human beings' life. So you can't release it at low height. So it is taken at height and released in a particular way. But it will not affect me because I am too short for it. Chemical tankers, they have double, like, you know, a petroleum product carrier. They got double skin and all, but they got different type of cleaning systems. They have got
on
inert gas. Same reason. Inert gas is common.
Niraj
And they got more tanks. Now, who is talking? Neil.
Sorry, sir.
Okay. This is a typical tanker cross profile view. Forward is same. I told you all the ships it is same. Then you have got tank number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 tanks. We will see from other side, but this side we can see 5 tanks for cargo. Somewhere in the middle there is manifold. Next to manifold you have got this crane to allow you, because whatever one pipe is here, shore pipe here, and ship's pipe is there. So this middle area has to be connected. So the shore pipe we pick up, we connect one end here, the other end those guys will connect. They normally theirs is connected. And what you get is a one, you know, there is a system something like this. And then there is a pipe which is connected on board. The actual system is something like this, but that is a shore system. And because, you know, there is a small movement of the ship, you don't want pipelines to rupture and oil to leak out. So crane is there. Then there is a store there to keep all the things, you know, like oil pollution stuff and all. This is that walkway I have shown. That means you start walking from here, you can come right to the forecastle because they have got low freeboard. I told you the tankers, because there are lesser openings, they are allowed to load deeper. Then pipeline obstructions, everything will be on deck. So you have got a walkway on top. This is the mast riser. This is for venting. This venting pipe is called mast riser. MAST mast. RISER. Riser. So that it releases hydrocarbon gases or inert gas or mixture of both on this height. Whereas you may be only up to here. Walkway is above your head. So you are safe. Now, tankers are required to have double bottom tanks. Reason being, if any accident happens here, any accident, what accident will be physical nature? You bang with other ship or object. Other one is you run aground on the rocks or something. So the bottom part gets ruptured. The two things, the front collision, every ship is provided with a collision bulkhead here, and 4-peak tank will get flooded with water, but cargo will not leak into the sea. If there is a grounding, you may get a hole here, but oil will not leak into the sea under normal situations, normal accidents, what are calculated. Another feature of a tanker is this has to be left empty. Why? This is engine room, this is engine room bulkhead, and this is the cargo bulkhead. Cargo bulkhead and engine room bulkhead cannot be same on tankers, because heat from engine can heat up this bulkhead and it may start fire here. That is the reason there has to be empty space in the middle. That is left by design. So it is cofferdam space. Now, cofferdam space is also allowed to be used as a pump room. And you'll find every ship uses this empty space as a pump room, where you have got pumps. It has got a very strong ventilation system. It has got hydrocarbon gas monitoring system. So before you enter, you switch on the light, fans will start automatically. Capacity is 20 times per hour. The whole volume of the air will be replaced 20 times per hour. The highest one on any merchant ship. Any merchant ship. Because there are, you know, pumps where some leakages may happen, then there will be hydrocarbon gases form. There can be fire. So we consider all this. And you have got the strongest ventilation system available. Then, lighting. Because the moment light is on means somebody is going down. So automatically the system starts. In spite of all the precautions, still it is a killer spot. In spite of all the precautions, we have told people, don't enter, don't enter. No, still somebody gets extra smart idea and hey, I can do it. Don't be a hero. There are no heroes at sea. We are professionals. Here, there will be ventilation, you know, ventilators on top. There will be entrances like this. You come on deck, you go through door, and then you go down. All the possibilities are considered. This can get flooded because of a leak in pipeline or something, because the pipelines end up here. Cargo pumps are here. Then pipelines go out from here to manifold. So there are many things. What you have to remember, it is one of the most dangerous places on ships. So a lot of precautions must be taken. Safety is boring at times, but it saves life. One mistake, person can be dead. That's it. Simple. Then you have got engine room, funnel, the superstructure and usual parts. This is the side view. Now, this drawing is little bit complex maybe. What you have to understand is this. Oi, what happened? Sorry, I clicked the wrong one. Okay, what happens is, what you have to remember is, we don't expect physical damage from top. Okay, one of you can always say that suppose asteroid hits. Possible. But that doesn't mean oil will leak out from top, because oil will stay down only, no? So it's not going to leak from top. Unless you are pumping it and pushing it out. Here, what you have to understand is this shape you should be able to draw. These are the tanks. Port tank, center tank, starboard tank. Now, this is the deck plating. This is deck plating. This is side shell plating. And this is the keel plating. On top of keel plating, you have got here double bottom tank. Right? That's a double bottom tank. Then, we have got this as a wing tank. It may be straight, it may be sliding. Whatever it is, okay, it may be straight also. No problem. This is empty space. Empty space when you are loading. Double bottom will be also empty because you want to load maximum cargo, so it will be empty space. So, in case there is an accident, what will happen? Hole will be there. If it is above the water level, not a big issue. If it is below water level, this tank will get flooded. Correct? To the water level. It will come to the water level and stop. So there is extra weight, but you have got reserve buoyancy. The ship is not going to sink because of that. Whereas, if there is a grounding damage, yes, water will fill it up, but nothing will touch the cargo. Now, this is compulsory on all the tankers because tankers do cause massive pollution and it becomes a very big problem to clean up. So, even though one can keep on arguing and all, actually, oil is a natural product. okay, crude oil and all. So it doesn't do that sort of a big harm to marine environment, because if you look at microorganism, everything, and it actually, a study says, it doesn't harm. But who will get harmed? Birds, migratory birds, etc., etc. Some fish will die because they are not used to it. Long term, it doesn't help. Cleaning cost is high. Economies of coast are based on tourism and all. So you lose tourist season. So it is a sensitive issue. The best thing, they said, make ship with double skin. So we calculate the risk that average accident can have this much of impact. And we are okay. So we will make allowance for that. Unless it's super massive something, you can't help it. That's accident. But we take precaution of it. Tankers will have cargo tanks, port, center, starboard. They will have wing tanks and double bottom. Under no circumstances, oil will share any bulkhead or in bracket wall with sea. There has to be something in the middle, empty spaces. So in case it leaks, okay. Another issue, suppose this tank leaks from here to here. No problem, both are cargo tanks. Now if this one leaks from here to here, we consider this possibility. For that, there is a monitoring system. So if we find anything is leaking there, we can empty it anyway. Any leakages are there, so immediately we fill up with inert gas and all to avoid any sort of fire or something. And after this is discharged, then we get it repaired. Older tankers, it is possible, but modern tankers are much better. So you are not likely to see this happening. Now, is it clear about tankers? Huh? Generation Z. Is it clear? Gen Z.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You understood basically what is a tanker?
Yes, sir.
Port, center, starboard tanks, two sides and the bottom have got tanks so that accidentally after collision or something, oil should not leak into the sea. That is the basic purpose. And then additionally, you have got mast risers to release the high pressure system. There is a walkway from aft to forward. Right? All things are clear?
So what is stringer?
Huh? Stringer? No, okay. So what is stringer? Okay, okay. These words. Okay. Just you need to remember inner hull, outer hull, longitudinal bulkhead. You can use this framing, just word use framing, because stringers and all are the typical construction phrase, terminology, not phrase, the terminology, light plate bracket and so on. Now here you have to show inner bottom, inner hull, outer hull, main deck. If you show something, fine, framing. Otherwise you just draw the straight line and say this is wing tank, this is double bottom tank. Tankers do not have duck keel. Got it? Got it, no?
Yes, sir.
Tankers do not have duck keel. Means I have not heard it till date. Unless they try to come out with something which I have doubts. Because in a normal sense, common sense doesn't permit. So, this shape you should be able to draw and this rectangle. Now, when you draw this rectangle, try to make it little bit curved one because there is something called camber. Four corners should be rounded. Okay. Now, for rounding, sometimes it is, you may have something that to round it properly. Drawing should look decent. Now, framing and all, the transverse web, plate bracket, stringer, you need not use these words. Floor, is a solid plate. All you have to show is double bottom tanks, wing tanks, deck plating, outer shell, like outer hull, inner hull, inner bottom, outer bottom. These words must be there. Got it?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we can, any doubts you have got now? Anybody has got doubts? Anyone? No? See, there are some doubts also. At least some odd doubts can be there. No? Like one of the doubt can be, if you feed chocolate to the cow, will she give chocolate milk? Heard these questions anytime? What? Heard?
No, sir.
Or if the white cow gives white milk, will black cow give black milk?